الله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. We resume inshallah our study of the dynasty of Bani Umayyad, the Umayyad state, Dawlat Bani Umayyad, that lasted from the 41st year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the year 132. And we last time got into the point after studying the life of Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik and how Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, who was the sixth Khalifa of the Umayyad dynasty, had given the recommendation and took the bay'ah, took the pledge for Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz to be the Khalifa after him. And today, inshallah, we start the life, the biography of this Khalifa, Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, radwanullahi alayhi. And Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz is a very famous name in our Islamic history. And for reasons that we have, inshallah, we try to cover in these sessions to come. And the reason that Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz was a very prominent name in the dynasty of Umayyah is because he was different from the rest of the Umayyad dynasty. And he is going back to the way of the guided Khalifa, Al-Khulafa al-Rashideen, radwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. And Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz's Khilafa lasted only for 2 years and 4 months. So the time of his Khilafa were not long. If you compare him to many of the other Khalifa in the dynasty of Umayyah, like Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik, Al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik, Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, they governed and they ruled for much, much longer time than the 2 years and 4 months of Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz. So we will see why these 2 years were very important and pivotal in our Islamic history. Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz radiyallahu an was born on the 61st year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he died in the year 101 after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was 40 years old. When he became a Khalifa, he was 37 years old, and when he died, he was 40. So he was a very young Khalifa, very young person in Umayyah. He actually became a governor of Medina when he was 25. So he was 25 years old and he was the governor of the Medina Munawwara, the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah, قال الخلفاء خمسة أبو بكر عمر عثمان وعلي وعمر بن عبد العزيز وهذا في كتاب أبو داود. Sufyan al-Thawri said the Khulafa are five: Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, as narrated by Abu Dawud. And why is he considered one of the guided Khalifa? Because of the revival of the Khilafa itself. When Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz came to become a Khalifa, the Muslim state was very powerful, was very wealthy. It didn't really need more expansion. As we seen before in the previous sessions, that the territory of the Islamic Khilafa stretched from the borders of China all the way to France. There was Kashgir on the east and Narbonne in the west. And all of that was under the reins of the Muslims. All the wealth of these territories, all the political stability and the reign of Bani Umayyah was at its peak at that time. So Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, he did not, his role was not to add territory, he was not a victorious conqueror. His role in our Islamic history was the revival of the role of the Khilafa. To revive the role of what the Khalifa should be doing and how the Khalifa is the role model and the true successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what the word means. Al-Khalifa is the successor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the one that actually embodied that definition in the dynasty of Umayyah was none else but Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz radiallahu anhu. What do we mean by the revival of the Islamic Khilafah? It's because Khilafah needed revival at that time. There was deviation from the path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the path of the guided Khalifa, the four guided Khalifa after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We went over that in detail last session. We go over them very quickly. The dynasty concept that was introduced by the people of Umayyah, tribal and national zealotry. We will study inshallah later on how Bani Umayyah, they revived what is called al-Asabiyya al-Qabaliyya. And they had, this is a tribal zealotry, and they had favored one tribe over the other. Eventually, it destroyed Bani Umayyah. We will see directly, the factors that directly destroyed the people of Bani Umayyah is the conflict that happened between al-Yamaniyin wal-Qaysiyin, the people of the Yamani tribes and the Qaysi tribes. And that actually played a major role in the destruction of the entire Umayyad dynasty. There were political and military alliances inside the government. There were rivalry between the leaders and the commanders and the governors within Umayyah. And that weakened the path of the Muslim state at that time. There were fear and loss of power. Umayyah looked at all powers that were emerging within the Muslim state as powers that are competing with their authority. And they suppressed many of them. And when a governor or a leader or a commander gets to a high position, they would be immediately demoted by the Khalifa in Damascus. And then the oppressing of the supporters of Ali radwanullah alayh, and the oppressing the Shia of Ali in Iraq, and then the distraction from the path of Islam by wealth, by power. So the real message of the Khilafah was distorted during that reign. And that's why Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, his coming was pivotal to revive the role of the Khalifa and to show us and to show history that even among the wealth, the power, Islam works and the values of the guided Khalifa works. And actually nothing brings happiness and justice. It was not all the money. It was not all the wealth that Umayyah brought to the Muslim state. People were not happier other than the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu. So when we go over his biography, first let's study the person. Who was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu alayhi, his birth, his upbringing, and who his parents were. If you go to his the family tree, he is from Umayyah. He is actually a direct descendant of Marwan ibn al-Hakam, who is a direct descendant of Umayyah ibn Abd Shams ibn Abd Manaf. He is related to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they meet in Abdu Manaf, who is the patriarch of the four major family of Quraysh: Al-Muttalibiyin, Al-Hashimiyin, Al-Umawiyin, and Bani Nawfal. So he is a direct descendant of Marwan ibn al-Hakam. His father was Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan. We will talk about him here in a little bit. And his mother is Layla. Layla, and her nickname was Ummu Asim, because she is the daughter of Asim, who is the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. So his grandfather, great-grandfather on his mother's side is Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he is related to the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam on his father's side, and he is also a direct descendant of Marwan ibn al-Hakam. His grandfather is very well known, Umar ibn al-Khattab, and the story of how Umar ibn al-Khattab got to become his father is a very important and a very good story to understand and know. Umar ibn al-Khattab was one of his nightly patrol in Medina. Like he used to do, he would check on his subject, he would check on people. And one time on his night patrol, he heard, and his servant Aslam was with him, and while he was checking, he heard voices. And it was an argument between a mother and a daughter. And the mother and the daughter had a profession, and they would sell milk. And the arguments went as follows. And the mother was telling her mother, the mother was telling the daughter, mix the milk with water. قُومِ إِلَى اللَّبَنِ فَمْذُقِيهِ مْذُقِيهِ meaning mix it with water. And the daughter told her mother, يَا أُمَّهِ أَمَا عَلِمْتِ بِمَا كَانَ مِنْ عَزْمَةِ أَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. قالت وما ذاك يا بني قالت أمر مناديه لا يشاب اللبن بالماء. The daughter said, didn't you not know what Umar has decreed? He decreed that milk cannot be mixed with water. You have to sell milk in its original state. Cannot be mixed with water. Because that is cheating. So the mother told her daughter, يا بني قومي إلى اللبن فامذقيه بالماء فإنه بموضع لا يراك فيه عمر ولا منادي عمر. She said, my daughter, go and mix it with water. Where it is now, Umar cannot see you. And the soldiers of Umar cannot see you. And the daughter told her mother, يا أماه إن كان عمر لا يعلم فإن الله يعلم والله ما كنت لأطيعه في الملأ وأعصيه في الخلاء. And the daughter said, if Umar cannot see, if Umar does not know what we're doing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see. And he knows what we are doing. I would not obey Umar in public and disobey him in privacy. And then Umar asked his servant Aslam to mark the door. And then he, next morning he said, check that daughter and see if she has a husband. And she was from the tribe of Hilal. And the mother was a widow and the daughter was an orphan. So Umar called upon his children and they were Abdullah, Abdurrahman and Asim. And he said, هل فيكم من يحتاج إلى امرأة فأزوجه؟ لو كان بأبيكم حركة إلى النساء ما سبقه منكم أحد إلى هذه الجارية. He said, does anybody need a wife? Because if your father has the will, has the wish to marry, then nobody would actually marry this daughter, this righteous person, other than Umar ibn al-Khattab, Amir al-Mu'mineen himself. Abdullah ibn Umar said, I have a wife. And Umar Abdurrahman ibn Umar said, I have a wife. And Asim said, I don't have a wife. And Umar ibn al-Khattab sent and he asked for that daughter in marriage to his son. So the orphan daughter, the milk seller, the milk, the one that sells the milk, one of the poorest houses in Medina, this daughter, by her righteousness, she got engaged and she married Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. And this blessed reunion produced a daughter, Layla. Umm Asim, her nickname was Umm Asim. Layla was engaged, she was asked to marry Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam. And Abdul Aziz was a prince in Umayyah. And Asim gave his daughter in marriage to Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan. And the result of this blessed reunion, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came. So this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, تَخَيَّرُوا لِنُطَفِكُمْ فَإِنَّ الْعِرْقَ دَسَّاسِ. Choose for your offsprings. Choose for your project. Choose the woman, meaning choose the women that you get married to. Choose the man that you give your daughters to. Because righteousness begets righteousness, and people when they are raised in a house that this is the mother and the grandmother is like this milk lady and the father and the grandfather is like Umar ibn Khattab, then you can expect an offspring like Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu. Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan, his father, he was a governor of Egypt. Egypt was one of the most powerful states and Ansar under the Islamic State. And Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan ibn al-Hakam was the governor of Egypt, and he that was in the year 65 after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One of the achievements of Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan that he built a city, the city of Helwan, which is still stands today in Egypt, and that was one of the things he did. And he governed Egypt with justice, and history records all good things for Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan. And he said, I followed an advice when I came to Egypt, and my father told me, he said, أُصِيقَ بِتَقْوَى اللَّهِ فِي سِرِّكَ وَعَلَانِيَتِكَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَاللَّهُ وَهُ الَّذِينَ هُمْ مُحْسِنُونَ. And he said, I ask you to fear Allah in secrecy and in privacy and in public, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who fear Him, those who have piety. And He said, أُوصِيكَ أَلَّا تَعْجَلَ فِي شَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْحُكْمِ حَتَّى تَسْتَشِيرُ. Do not rush into judgment in your ruling until you consult with others. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ لَوْ أَغْنَى أَحَدًا عَنْ ذَلِكَ لأغنى نبيه محمدا عن صلى الله عليه وسلم بالوحي الذي يأتيه حيث قال سبحانه وتعالى وشاورهم في الأمر. He said if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want anyone to consult with others, then He would ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, who had all the wisdom, not to consult with others, but He asked the Prophet to consult and said وشاورهم في الأمر. And that was the way of governing of Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan. We're bringing this up to know how Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was raised in this house. He was getting, he was nursing this way of governing, seeing his father Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan governing Egypt. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was raised initially in Al-Madinah. And as we saw, he was the his grandfather is Asim ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab. So his uncle on his mother's side is Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab radwanullahi alayhima. And when he was raised in Medina, he would go to who's his uncle, Abdullah ibn Umar. And Abdullah ibn Umar is one of the great scholars of Islam. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz had the advantage that his uncle and his scholar was also his teacher, Abdullah ibn Umar. And he would come to his mother and he would say, Ya Ummah, uhibbu an akuna mithla khali. I like to be like my uncle, Abdullah ibn Umar. He loved to get the knowledge of Islam. He loved the majlis, the seating around the halaqat al-ilm, around the circles of knowledge like Abdullah ibn Umar. And she would smile at him and say, أنت تكون مثل خالك إن شاء الله. You will be like your uncle إن شاء الله. And Abdullah ibn Umar was happy to teach Umar ibn Abdul Aziz as much as possible. Then Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan became governor of Egypt. And he was summoned to leave Medina and go to Egypt like we said. So they wanted to take the family and go on to Egypt. But Abdullah ibn Umar talked to his niece and he said, خَلِّ فِي هَذَا الْغُلَامَ عِنْدَنَا فَإِنَّهُ أَشْبَهَكُمْ بِنَا آلَ عُمَرٍ. He said, leave this boy with us. Leave Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, meaning in the house of Abdullah ibn Umar. Because he said, this boy is not like Bani Umayyah. He is more like the people of Umar ibn Khattab. أَشْبَهَكُمْ بِنَا آلَ عُمَرٍ. He said, he was more like us. Don't let him go to Egypt and leave him with us. So Abdul Aziz was happy and he left Umar ibn Abdul Aziz in Medina. And the governor of Al-Medina at that time, and Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, who became a Khalifa later on, he was one of the people that were residing in Medina. So he left them in the custody of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And that's how he started his youth among the greatest scholars in Al-Medina. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu is considered one of At-Tabi'een. One of At-Tabi'een because he was raised and he took directly his knowledge from Al-Medina, from the scholars and from As-Sahaba. To qualify as a Tabi'i, you have to take the knowledge directly from As-Sahaba, and one of the first Sahaba was Abdullah ibn Umar, and then he took it also from the great Tabi'een, Ubaydullah ibn Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhuma, and Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, we studied his life and we took some time to go over his station in Islam, and he's one of the great Tabi'een, he's one of the greatest scholars in Islam, and he was one of the people that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz studied under, and he later on continued to study under when Umar ibn Abdul Aziz himself became the governor of Al-Medina. Then on one trip, his father summoned him to come to Egypt, and on his way to Egypt, he fell off a camel, and he had a big gash in his forehead. So he had a big scar on his forehead, and he is was named after that scar in his forehead, and he was called Al-Ashaj, Ashaj Bani Umayyah. And he was this scar forehead of the people of Umayyah, and that was actually a nickname that followed. And there is some narration that Umar ibn al-Khattab predicted that there would be a man with of his progeny from who would rule with justice, and he would have scar in his forehead. Wallahu alam. And Allah knows best. But he was raised as a prince in Umayyah. Umayyah had all the wealth, had all the fortune. His father was a governor in Egypt. And here is Abdullah ibn Umar as a young man coming up and being brought up in great wealth. So he was one of the people during his youth that actually indulged in the luxury that was provided in the palaces of the people of Umayyah. He was very well dressed, very well groomed, and he would always smell the scent of perfumes and beautiful clothes. And it was narrated that one of his garments would worth almost 1,000 dinar, which is a small fortune at that time. It's actually a big fortune at that time to have. That's one of his garments. And when that garment would be brought to him, he would say, "This is too rough for my skin." And he would he was very much into this life of luxury, like the rest of the houses of Bani Umayyah. And we will see how that will change 180 degrees around. The family of Umar ibn al-Abdul Aziz, radwanullah alayhi, we'll talk about that. First, let's talk about his looks. He was described as tall. He was he was thin. He was not an obese person. He was light complexed, as he was narrated. As we said, he had a scar in his forehead. And then later on in his life, he took over his great grandfather Umar ibn Khattab, and he became bald. But during his youth, he had head full of hair. But we know Umar ibn Khattab was bald, and later on Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was also bald. Raja ibn Haywa al-Kindi said, "Umar kana Umar ibn Abdul Aziz min a'tar al-nas wa albas al-nas wa akhyaluhum fi mashyatihi فلما استخلف قوموا ثيابه باثني عشر درهما." Raja ibn Haywa, the person that actually recommended Umar ibn Abdul Aziz to become a Khalifa, he said he was one of the best dressed people in Umayyah, one of the best groomed people of Umayyah. And later on, when he became a Khalifa, his entire clothing was not worth 12 dirham, which is nothing. We will see the comparison of what happened to him. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz married into the house of Umayyah. And one of his wives was Fatima bint Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Fatima, the daughter of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And if we go back to the family tree of Bani Umayyah, Abd al-Malik ibn Marwan, his daughter Fatima, who is the cousin of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, she was married to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. But you can see Fatima, she was raised in a house of glory and a house of nobility in Umayyah and in Quraysh. Four of her brothers were Khalifa. Her father was a Khalifa and her husband was a Khalifa. And historians said that was not to any other woman in Islamic history, that she was directly related to actually 8 Khalifa. Her father, 4 brothers, 2 nephews, and her husband. They're all Khalifa in her own family. So she came from a great house of nobility and great house of Khilafa and great house of governing Islam. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi. After he married Fatima, One of the things that history narrates, the things that happened between Fatima, this daughter of the Khalifa, the sister of the Khalifa, and the wife of the Khalifa. So when he became Khalifa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, as we will see, he told her that now he is starting a new page in his life and things will change. This luxury will not be anymore. And he gave her the option to go back to her the palaces of her brothers and her family, or to stay with him in his modest house. And she asked to stay with him in his house. And he also asked her to return all the jewelry that were given to her by her father, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And she gave that back to the treasury of the Muslims. So after Umar ibn Abdul Aziz died, the brothers, her brother who became a Khalifa, wanted to give her back her jewelry. He said, now the person that asked you to give the jewelry back is dead. Here's your jewelry back. You can enjoy this wealth that your father left for you. And she refused. So that tells you her nobility, her sincerity as well. Rahimahullah, Fatima bint Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And he also had his many children, but the most famous of which is his son Abdul Malik. And we stop a little bit to look at Abdul Malik ibn Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, who was one of the righteous people. He was also an inheritance of that tradition of Umar ibn al-Khattab. One of the things that are recorded in history of Abdul Malik, the son of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, is when he was given the bay'ah for Khilafah, it was a very hard day for Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He refused to ride the horses of the Khalifa, and he kept on saying, "Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un," like a big catastrophe happened to him. So he walked back into his house after he gave the khutbah that we will go over, inshallah. And then his 17-year-old son saw his father walking into the house, and Layn wanted to take a nap. And he said, "Ma turidu an tasna'a ya Amir al-Mu'mineen?" What do you want to do, Amir al-Mu'mineen? And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz told his son Abdul Malik, "Ay bunayya, uridu an aghfu qaleelan, falam tabqa fi jasadi taqa." He said, "I'm so exhausted, I have no energy. I need to just take a little nap." It was a hard day for Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. So Abdul Malik said, "Ataghfu qabla an tarudda al-mazalima ila ahliha ya Amir al-Mu'mineen?" He said, "You want to take a nap before you put justice back where it belongs?" And then he said, "Ay bunayya, sahirtu al-bariha fi ammika Sulayman." When the Khalifa died, he said, "I was up all night burying him and preparing him." And he said, "When it's time," and this was after Fajr, and he said, "When it's time for Dhuhr, and I will pray in with the people, and then we will give justice back to the people." So Abdul Malik said, "وَمَنْ لَكَ أَن تَعِيشَ إِلَى الظُّهْرِ يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ?" Who guarantees that you would live to the time of Salatul Dhuhr, يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ? This was Abdul Malik ibn Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz said, "Idnu min ya bunay." فَقَبَّلَ مَا بَيْنَ عَيَنَيْهِ. He kissed him, he kissed him on his forehead, and he said, "Alhamdulillah, الَّذِي أَخْرَجَ مِن صُلْبِي مَن يُعِينُنِي عَلَى دِينِي." Alhamdulillah, who got from my offsprings, who can help me for my religion. And he kept on advising his father throughout his khilafah, throughout his time. And he was one of the wisest people. He was one of the most pious people. And what happened is Abdul Malik ibn Umar ibn Abdul Aziz died before the khilafah of his father ends. He was a very young guy, and he died during the life of his father. And his father was crying him and praising him and ihtisab, making the ihtisab with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And people came to him and they said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, would you have given the succession to Abdul Malik? Would you have given him Khilafah after you? Is that what?" He said, "No, I would not. He would not make it a dynasty." And he said, "I'm afraid that whatever I feel for my son is what a father would feel for losing a child, but I would never make him a Khalifa." There are many really stories of Abdul Malik ibn Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, this young person who was really an example for youth and piety and obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and always giving advice to his father. But inshallah we may go over that later on. But the history is really filled with many stories of Abdul Malik ibn Amr ibn Abdul Aziz, so he was really very important to mention that. We saw that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz had his knowledge, acquired knowledge in the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, and some of his teachers were Abdullah ibn Umar in his youth, and then later on he came back to Al-Medina as a young person when he required knowledge, and then he came to it a third time when he was a governor in Medina. So there was three stages where Umar ibn Abdul Aziz took knowledge in Al-Medina when he was very young with his uncle Abdullah ibn Umar, later on during his youth. And his teacher in Al-Medina was Salih ibn Kaysan. Salih ibn Kaysan was one of the great tabi'een, and he was one of the teachers of Umar ibn Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiyallahu anhu. Gathered the Quran, he memorized the Quran when he was young, and Salih ibn Kaysan became his teacher later on in Al-Medina. And his father asked Salih ibn Kaysan about the progress of his son Umar, and he said, ما خبرت أحدا الله أعظم في صدره من هذا الغلام. He said, I have not seen a young person that Allah is more glorified and great in his heart than this young, than this youth, this Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And one time, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was late for the Salah. So his teacher, Salih ibn Kaysan, said, what happened? Why are you late? He said, my nanny was combing my hair. So he was late because his hair was taken care of. And he wrote a letter, Salih ibn Kaysan, wrote a letter to Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan. And he said, your son was late for prayer because of his hair being taken care of. So Abdul Aziz ibn Marwan wrote his son Umar that he is not talking to him until he shaves all his hair. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz shaved the hair. But you see the upbringing, you see the role of parenting, the role of teaching, and making great people, and making people that know their priorities, even when they are young and when they are children. So when Abdul Aziz died later on, he was called to Damascus by the Khalifa Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Knowing who Abdul Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was, he gave him his daughter Fatima in marriage. During his life in Medina, when he became a governor of Medina, when he became Amir of Medina, he continued his knowledge. He continued asking knowledge. So he was the Amir, and he was 25 years old, but he would call the righteous people of Medina, he would call the fuqaha, the scholars, to teach the Amir. So this was his longing to knowledge, his longing to learn the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And some of his most important teachers were Ubaydullah ibn Abdullah ibn Utbah ibn Mas'ud, and also Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. We studied the life of Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr as well, and he also took knowledge from Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib during his time as a governor. And that's why he is considered a great tabi'i. He is considered a tabi'i, and he is considered a scholar in Islam. So this Khalifa was not only a prince and man of wealth and power, but he was of great knowledge. And if I take one testimony in history, I would take the testimony of Ahmad ibn Hanbal radiyallahu anhu. The Imam of al-Madhhab al-Hanbali, he said, لا أدري قول أحد من التابعين حجة إلا قول عمر بن عبد العزيز. He said, I don't take as a reference the words of any of the tabi'een. He had very high, inshallah we will study the a'imma, we'll study the imams, but Ahmad ibn Hanbal had a very high standard to take reference and to take evidence to Sharia. He said, I take it from none of the tabi'een except Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. So that tells us the degree of knowledge and degree of the scholar information in Islam that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz has reached. Then Umar ibn Abdul Aziz became a governor in Medina. And he was appointed in the year of 87 after the hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was 25 years old. And he was summoned by Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik. Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik, the son of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And he summoned his cousin, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, to become Amir of Medina. Then later on, in the 90th year after the Hijrah, 3 years later, he added Mecca and Al-Ta'if. So he became governor of the entire province of Hijaz. And that was a very important training time for Umar ibn Abdul Aziz as a governor. The first time in his youth, who became a man of power and authority and of ruling. And that we will see how he started lifting oppression in Medina. At that time, why Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was chosen for this position? There was a governor in Medina whose name was Hisham ibn Ismail al-Makhzumi. And he used to be a tyrant. He had a lot of authority, and he oppressed the people in Medina. And anger started boiling in Medina, and that reached al-Khalifa, al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik. So he wanted to send somebody who can smooth things out, who can cool things down, who has wisdom, and also gentle in the way he governs. And that's why Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was chosen. And then once he became a governor of Medina, he had a council. And his council was filled with scholars. And he had 11 people that he made as his shura council. And there were Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, his own teacher, Urwa ibn al-Zubayr, Ubaydullah ibn Abdullah ibn Utbah, Abu Bakr ibn Abd al-Rahman ibn al-Harith, Abu Bakr ibn Sulaiman ibn Huthma, Sulaiman ibn Yasar, Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, one of the great Tabi'een, Salim ibn Abdullah ibn Umar, and Abdullah ibn Amir ibn Rabi'a, wa Kharija ibn Zayd ibn Thabit. He had a council of scholars. This was his advisory board. So that tells you the way that he started his government, how he preferred to take advice, not from the wealthy, not from the powerful, but from the most knowledgeable people. And then he started his strategy of corrections and rebuilding. And one of the great attributes of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is the rebuilding and the expansion of the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that happened during his reign. However, there was some rivalry that started between the governor of Hijaz and the governor of Iraq. Hijaz was not militarily or economically important for the people of Umayyah, but obviously it is the center of Islam. Mecca and Al-Madinah and all the scholars, and Umar was there. And in Al-Iraq, which was important economically and militarily to the people of Umayyah, at that time during the reign of Al-Walid ibn al-Malik, was governed by Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf Saqafi. Now, you cannot contrast two governors more than you can Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi with his tyranny, with his oppression, with his policy of the sword, and Umar ibn Abdul Aziz with his policy of bringing scholars together. I mean, here's the man that killed Sa'id ibn Jubayr, and here's the man that actually has his council of At-Tabi'een. Here's the man that his prisons were filled with people, and here's the man that smoothed down and calmed down politics in Al-Medina. So what happened is Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi came to Al-Hajj, came to pilgrimage in the 92nd year after the Hijrah, 92nd year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and wanted to come by, and usually the way to Al-Hajj passes through Al-Medina. So Al-Hajjaj wanted to visit Al-Medina on his way, and Umar ibn Abdul Aziz wrote to the Khalifa and he said, people are angry because Al-Hajjaj wants to pass through Al-Medina. And he asked Al-Khalifa, Al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik, to ask Al-Hajjaj to bypass Al-Medina and not stop where Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz is. And Al-Hajjaj was ordered by Al-Khalifa not to stop in Medina, but he became very angry with Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz for that request. So that started some animosity between Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi and Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz. So later on, after Al-Hajjaj went back to Al-Iraq, he sent to Al-Khalifa and he said, إِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِنْ مُرَّاقِ أَهْلِ الْعِرَاقِ قَدْ جَلُوا عَنِ الْعِرَاقِ وَلَجَأُوا إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ وَمَكَّةِ وَفِي ذَلِكَ وَهْنٌ وَضَعْفٌ. He said, many of the outlaws, many of the rebels, many of the people that that do not respect the authority of Umayyah now are leaving Iraq and going to Mecca and Al-Medina. He's trying to make it a security issue. He's making it like people are gathering in Mecca and Al-Medina, and Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is not strong enough to deal with it. People are leaving from under my iron grip and going to where Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is. And he kept asking the Khalifa to change this until the Khalifa finally asked Umar ibn Abdul Aziz to step down in the 93rd year after the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then when he left in Sha'ban in the 93 years, the 93rd year after the Hijrah, and he was very sad. And he said, I am afraid that I would be one of the people that Medina expels. Medina does not like to keep in it. Then he went to Syria. He went to a little ranch that he had in southern Syria, and right above where today the borders of Jordan and Syria is, in a little town called Suwayda, still a city in Syria today. And in there he had a small ranch, and he had his servant of his, Muzahim, Ibn Abi Muzahim, and he just stayed there in Asham, and he then started advising Al-Walid Ibn Abdul Malik, who was Al-Khalifa, when he was asked for advice. And he would listen to the news of Al-Hajjaj and the tyranny of Al-Hajjaj and the killing and the imprisonment of people, and he would say, امتلأت الأرض والله جورا فأرح الناس. Oh Allah, this land is now filled with transgression, so give respite to people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered the prayer of Umar in Umar himself. He was the respite, he was this comfort that people had in those very hard times. His advice to Al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik, he would come to the court of Al-Walid in Damascus, and he would tell him, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَعْدَ الشِّرْكِ إِثْمٌ أَعْظَمُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ مِنَ الدَّمِ وَإِنَّ عُمَّالَكَ يَقْتُلُونَ وَيَكْتُبُونَ لَكَ ذَنْبَ الْمَقْتُولِ وَأَنْتَ الْمَسْئُولُ عَنْهُ وَالْمَأْخُوذُ بِهِ. He would say to Al-Walid, he said, there is no worse of a sin in the eyes of Allah after a shirk but the blood of a Muslim. And your governors, meaning mostly Al-Hajjaj and others, are killing people. And that blood is recorded in your own record. This blood, you are responsible for it because you are the Khalifa. And then Al-Walid would answer him, Barakallahu fika ya Aba Hafs. And he would ask Allah to bless him, but they would not change this policy. Later on, Al-Walid died. And then Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik became the Khalifa. And Sulaiman actually asked Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz to be with him. He made him very close to him and to his court, and he made him one of his councilmen. So Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz was closer to Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, and we will see how that actually ended up when Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik gave the Khilafah to Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz. And he actually recommended to Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik to make the governors of Al-Hajjaj step down, and Al-Hajjaj had died at that time in the reign of Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. Then we know what happened, and we studied that in detail last time when Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik was dying, and his wazir, his secretary, Raja ibn Haywa al-Kindi, who was from Jordan, who came to Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, and he gave him an advice to recommend the Khilafah to Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz. And we studied how it was in a sealed letter, and this sealed letter was giving to the people of Umayyah without knowing who's the name of the next Khalifa. They gave their pledge to Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz without knowing. Then later on, they asked when the Khalifa became very sick, they asked the people of Umayyah to gather again. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came to the masjid And he came to talk to Raja, who had this letter from the Khalifa, and he said, أُنَاشِدُكَ اللَّهِ أُنَاشِدُكَ اللَّهَ يَا رَجَاءَ. I ask you by Allah, يَا رَجَاءَ. He said, if you know that my name is in this, let me know so I can talk to the Khalifa before the Khalifa dies. And Raja would say, أُنَاشِدُكَ اللَّهِ, that I cannot, I ask you by Allah not to make me say that, because I would not betray the secret of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik, on the other hand, would come to Raja and he would say, وَنَاشِدُكَ اللَّهِ, that if my name is not in there, let me know so I can go talk to the Khalifa. He wanted to become a Khalifa after Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. However, after that, he died, Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, and Raja asked people to give the pledge again, and they did. Then he saw Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz sitting at the back of the masjid. So he came to bring him closer. And he went to him and he said, As-salamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, when he was given the greeting as Amir al-Mu'mineen, his color was changed and he said, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Inna, like a disaster, a calamity hit him. And he said, أُنْشِدُكَ اللَّهَ يَا رَجَاء. I ask you by Allah, يَا رَجَاء, don't do this. And Raja said, أُنَاشِدُكَ اللَّهَ أَنْ يَطَّرِبَ بِالنَّاسِ حَبْلٍ. He said, if you don't accept it, there will be tribulation, there will be fitna, there will be problems. He said, لَقِيَ سُلَيْمَانُ رَبَّهُ. Sulaiman is already dead. It doesn't help to avoid the responsibility. So the way that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was described is he was carried from the back of the masjid, because his legs would not carry him. His legs, his knees could not carry him from the weight of the responsibility that he felt. You see, you contrast that with Hisham ibn Abd al-Malik, who was fighting for it. He wanted to be a Khalifa, he wanted the wealth, he wanted the glory. And here is Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, his legs could not carry him from the back of the masjid to the front of the masjid. And he was carried by two people until they got him on the minbar. And then people gave the bay'ah like they did with the book. Then Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, threw what at that time is unimaginable political bomb. He got on the minbar and he said, أيها الناس, all people, إني قد ابتليت بهذا الأمر من غير رأي كان مني فيه ولا طلبة له ولا مشورة من المسلمين. He said, I was giving this khilafah, I was giving this without my opinion. I was not asked and I did not concur. وَلَا طَلَبَ. I never asked for it. وَلَا مَشُورَةٍ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. There was no shura. There was no shura among the Muslims when this was given to me. وَإِنِّي قَدْ خَلَعْتُ مَا فِي أَعْنَاقِكُمْ مِنْ بَيْعَتِي فَاخْتَارُوا لِأَنفُسِكُمْ. He said, I'm relieving you from your bay'ah. You have no bay'ah anymore. You choose a khalifa on your own. He put it back into the shura. Now people, the elite and the people, the public that was in the masjid, he said, اخترناك يا أمير المؤمنين ورضينا بك. They could not believe their ears. Somebody from Umayyah doesn't want to become a khalifa, doesn't want to get all that authority. فلأمرنا باليمن والبركة. Lead us with blessing and with righteousness. So after that, Umar ibn al-Khattab got on the minbar and he gave a great khutbah, a great speech, and we will see some of the outlines of this khutbah. He said, بعد حمد الله والثناء عليه, after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, أيها الناس, إنه لا كتاب بعد القرآن ولا نبي بعد محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, there is no book after the Quran, meaning the doctrine of government that I will lead is very clear. It is the Quran. That's the first sentence he said. He said, there is no book after the Quran. ولا رسول ولا نبي بعد محمد. And there is no path that I can go and walk on other than the path of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, وَلَا أَلَا وَإِنِّي لَسْتُ بِقَاضٍ وَلَكِنِّي مُنَفِّذٍ. I don't rule, I don't judge, I don't rule, I don't make up things, but I execute. I do what's in that book and what is in the way of the Prophet ﷺ. He's telling them, the way of this government is very clear. He said, وَلَسْتُ بِمُتَّبِعْ وَلَكِنِّي مُتَّبِعْ. I'm not an innovator, I'm a follower. I'm a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a follower of the righteous and guided Khalifa after him. He said, وَلَسْتُ بِخَيْرٍ مِّنْ أَحَدِكُمْ وَلَكِنِّي أَثْقَلُكُمْ حِمْلًا. I'm not better than any of you, but I am the one with the heaviest weight. I'm the one with the heaviest burden. And that reminds us of the speech of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu when he was given the Khilafah, when he said, أيها الناس وليتُ عليكم ولستُ بخيركم. And he was the best of them. And there is no doubt that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is the best of Umayyah. He said, I am not the best of you, but I'm the one with the heaviest burden. And he said, وَإِنَّ الرَّجُلَ الْهَارِبَ مِنَ الْإِمَامِ الظَّالِمِ لَيْسَ بِظَالِمِ أَلَا لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ. He said, if you see men fearing and escaping and fleeing from oppression, they are not oppressors. Meaning there is something wrong. When you see people in a government, when you see people fearing the government of oppression, he said, those people are not oppressors. Those people need to be listened to. أَلَا أَنَّهُ لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ. There is no obedience for a creature who is created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the disobedience of the creator, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's how he opened his speech. And of the highlights of his speech as well, he said, أيها الناس من أطاع الله وجبت طاعته ومن عصى الله فلا طاعة له أطيعوني ما أطعت الله فإن عصيت الله فلا طاعة لي عليكم. And this is a highlight, and it is reiterated by every guided Khalifa since Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He said, if I follow the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you obey me and you help me. And if I deviate from the path of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then there is no obedience for me over you. And then he said, إِنَّ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ لَمْ تَخْتَلَفْ فِي رَبِّهَا وَلَا فِي نَبِيِّهَا وَلَا فِي كِتَابِهَا وَإِنَّمَا اخْتَلَفُوا فِي الدِّنَارِ وَالدِّرْهَمِ وإني والله لا أعطي أحد باطلا ولا أمنع لا أعطي أحدا باطلا ولا أمنع أحدا حقا. He said, this nation, this Muslim ummah, did not have a conflict about who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, we all have the same degree, the same faith in Allah, and we have the same faith in our Prophet, we have the same faith in our book. But we have problems when it comes to the dinar and the dirham. That's when conflicts in this ummah. And that's the way of Bani Umayyah at that time. Fighting over wealth. Who gets more? Who get paid more? Who has more wealth? Who has more authority? Who is closer to the Khalifa? That was the things that were eating up in the body of the Umayyah dynasty and the Khilafah at that time. And he said, this is the problem. It's the dirham and the dinar. It's the money. That's the problem that we have. And he said, Wallahi inni la u'ti ahadan batila. I will not give anyone out of injustice. And that was the first sign to Bani Umayyah that they were going to be in trouble during the reign of this man. He said, I'm not giving anything to any of you that is a batil. That is not right. You will not get any wealth out of the misfortune of others. وَلَا أَمْنَعُ أَحَدًا حَقًّا. And everyone will get their due right. If you have a right, you will get it. And subhanAllah, as I go through this speech, I just hear the echo of this speech of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when he said, الْقَوِيُّ فِيكُمْ ضَعِيفٌ عِنْدِي حَتَّى أَخُذَ لَهُ الْحَقِّ وَالضَّعِيفُ فِيكُمْ قَوِيٌّ عِنْدِي حَتَّى وَالضَّعِيفُ فِيكُمْ قَوِيٌّ عِنْدِي حَتَّى أَخُذَ لَهُ الْحَقِّ. That whoever has the right, I am his supporter until the right reaches them. And whoever is being oppressed, then I am their supporter until this oppression is lifted. And those who are oppressors and transgressors, I will be the one that will take the rights away from them. Then he said, أيها الناس من صحبنا فليصحبنا بخمس أو ليفارقنا. He said, those who wants to be with us, let them be with us with five things, or let them leave us alone. Let them be away from us. You have five conditions to be with the Khalifa. What are these conditions? Inshallah, we'll conclude with that. He said, يرفع لنا حاجة من لا يستطيع رفعها. Those who wants to be with us, they're the ones that will tell us about any transgression and oppression that we cannot hear about otherwise, that we can, that cannot reach us. ويعيننا على الخير بجهده. The second condition is to help us for righteousness. وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى. He said, those who want to help us to do good, they can be with the Khalifa. ويدلنا من الخير على ما لا نهتدي إليه. That they will lead us to the path of righteousness and goodness. Show us the way. So this is the same again like Abu Bakr said, إن أحسنت فأعينوني وإن أسأت فقوموني. He said, those that will want to show us the right way, they can be with us. And then the fourth condition, ولا يغتابن عندنا أحدا. They cannot backbite anybody in front of us, in front of the Khalifa. ولا يعرضن فينا لا يعني. And they shall not speak in things that is not of their affair. And that's how he started his khilafah. And that was how he started his khutbah. And after that, he wrote letters to his governors. And inshallah, that's how we're going to start next session and see how the Muslim world was waiting for this khalifa. How Islam was waiting for this khalifa to revive the way of al-khulafa al-rashideen, the guided khalifa. قولوا قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فيا فوز المستغفرين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.